Everyone, hello, everyone. Welcome to all of you. Thank you for joining us today. I hope you are all doing very well and are taking good care of yourself and your near and dear ones. Today, we bring to you the second edition of our online workshop series on scientific writing and research ethics. The edition has been specially crafted for researchers and students of veterinary and animal sciences. My name is Yukti. I'm Communications and Public Engagement Officer at DBT Wellcome Trust India Alliance, and I'll be your host for today's workshop. Let's start with a quick introduction of India Alliance. So DBT Wellcome Trust India Alliance is an independent, dynamic public charity that funds research in health and biomedical sciences in India. India Alliance invests in transformative ideas and supportive research ecosystems to advance discovery and innovation to improve health and well-being. It is jointly funded by the Department of Biotechnology, Government of India and the Wellcome Trust UK. For more information, please do visit our website www.indiaalliance.org. to get more information on the fellowships, research grants, and other events and workshop. You can also follow us on social media through various handles, which I'll share with you shortly. So India Alliance periodically conducts one-day science communication workshops that we call SciComm 101 throughout the year at different institutions across the country. The goal is to sensitize young researchers about the importance of written and oral communication skills in not just advancing their careers, but in building public trust and support for science. So you may be doing some fantastic and cutting-edge research, but if you are unable to communicate your work, what good it is? So these professional skills may come in handy in any career that you choose to pursue. So under the current circumstances, standard avenues of doing physical outreaches and in-person workshops are unavailable due to restrictions in place because of the pandemic. However, virtual events prove to be a viable alternative for these training programs during this period. So we hope that you all find today's workshop useful and you participate actively and engage significantly with our trainers and make the most of it. So moving forward, I would actually like to introduce you to my colleagues, Vanya Kar and Rahul Dutta from India Alliance and Neha Vyas from Editage, our knowledge and training partner for this workshop. We have all worked together to organize and facilitate this workshop. Before we dive into the workshop, a few housekeeping matters. The webinar is being recorded. So if any of your friends or colleagues miss out on today's webinar, you can always follow the webinar through the recording, which will be available through India Alliance YouTube channel. If you have any questions, please start your statement with question. And if you have a comment, please start your statement with a comment. It will help the moderator. You can type in your questions and comments anytime in the chat box. If in case the webinar ends abruptly due to any technical glitch, please join back using the same registration link. So please make a note that we'll be issuing the e-certificate to all of those who attend the entire workshop and also submit the feedback survey form that you will receive after the workshop. And please note that the certificate will be issued within 5 working days. So, and if you plan to share any highlights from the workshop, please do that. And please feel free to tag us on the social media. Here's the agenda of the workshop. We'll start with the first session on basics of scientific writing and structuring your manuscript. This will be a 1 hour long session followed by 15 minutes of Q&A. We'll take a short 5 minutes break and then the second session will be on ethics and research and communications. Again, a 1 hour long session. And this will be followed by general Q&A session for 30 minutes. And the last session will be on careers and networking in veterinary and animal sciences. So I'll again state that Editage is our training and knowledge partner for this workshop. And it's our pleasure to introduce you to our workshop trainers today, Ms. Malti Ganeshan, who will be taking the first session on scientific writing. And the second session will be taken by Dr. Sunaina Singh, which is on research ethics. So Malti is assistant managing editor in the life sciences and academic trainer with Editage from past 5 years. Malti is proud to have the privilege of helping researchers communicate their work to the larger community, and she believes that effective communications is the backbone of collaborative science in 21st century. With that, I'll welcome Malti. Over to you. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Good morning. I hope that the gloomy weather has not, you know, is not in any way taking away from what you take away from the workshop. So I'll just dive right in because I feel like I have quite a bit to get through in the 1 hour. So in terms of questions, I'm not obviously going to be spending a lot of time monitoring the chat because the vagaries of presentation, I'll be focusing on the presentation window. So please reserve your questions if you can. If there's something particularly urgent, then I'll check the chat a couple of times during the session, and then if there's any urgent questions, I'll take them there. All right, I'm going to turn off my video in the interest of ensuring that I don't lose connectivity, and then I'll get right on to it. All right. Yes, so as we said, I'll be talking about scientific writing and manuscript structure, the basics. I've emphasized the basics because this is something that you can spend 2 days talking about and you still will not run out of things to say. So I won't say we're scratching the surface, but there's a lot more that we can say. I'll just be going through the basics of everything. All right. So why does scientific writing and manuscript structure even become important? Now, the primary reason this is the case is because in an ideal world, you would expect that journals would only care about the science. Now, the way that science works in the 21st century is that, you know, unless you publish, unless other scientists are able to access your work, it's obviously going to have less use and less effect and less impact. And like I said, in an ideal world, journals would only care about the science. The presentation, the language would not be as important, but the things being the way that they are, it's important. It's not just because of what journals expect, but it's also a more effective way to communicate your results if you sort of are able to plug the gaps that journals also use to reject manuscripts. Now, these can be deficiencies in the study itself. For example, the study design might not be adequate. You might have inadequate statistical analysis. You might not have sufficient data to make the inferences that you would like to make based on your findings. Now, that's something that's intrinsic to the study itself. Now, issues that should be addressed well before the point where you start actually writing your paper. The issues that can come up when you're actually at the stage of writing the manuscript are the second two categories I've mentioned here, which is poor presentation and lack of understanding of the journal requirements and the target readership. Now, in terms of poor presentation, this could be presentation of the study itself. So, for example, inadequate descriptions of the results or suboptimal reporting. If the methods are not fully explained or fully understandable to a scientifically literate audience, if you get carried away in the discussion, if you overemphasize or overinterpret your results, and if your writing impedes the reader's understanding of the work that you have done. So that's what I mean by poor writing. Now, scientific writing is not expected to be, you know, lyrical or eloquent or beautiful. The function of scientific writing is that it makes your research comprehensible. So that's what I mean by poor writing. And the last thing is a lack of understanding of the journal requirements and the target readership. Now, obviously, when you submit your manuscript to a journal, you're hoping that the audience that you want to read your paper is actually reading your paper. That's where your choice of journal becomes critical, because you want the right audience to be able to access your paper. And once you've chosen your journal, obviously all journals have sort of requirements that they expect manuscripts to follow in terms of format, in terms of presentation, in terms of structure. So if your manuscript doesn't meet those requirements, then that becomes an additional impediment for the journal to accept or reject the manuscript. Right. And obviously picking the wrong journal is something that journals will say that, no, this is not the right paper for this particular publication. Okay, let's move on. Yeah, so talking about scientific writing in particular, like I said, this is a very, very broad topic. So what I'm going to give you is kind of a tasting menu of the main points of scientific writing, and specifically what scientific writing is expected to accomplish. Like I said, the purpose of scientific writing is to communicate your research to the appropriate audience. So you want to keep it brief. You don't want to detract from the message that you're trying to convey. You want to keep it simple. You don't want your delivery to be so complex that your message is lost. You want to be precise, which is, I think, more important for scientific writing than for maybe any other type of communication. And you don't want to let your language distract the reader from your message. So this means that neither do you want your language to be poor, nor do you want your language to be difficult to comprehend for another reader, nor do you want your language to be so complex and so flowery that the reader is more focused on your sentences than on what you're saying. So it goes both ways. Okay, so that said, we'll just quickly go through a few common errors in scientific writing and how you can avoid them. And I'll be talking about 4 major error categories. I'll be talking about 1 specific error type in each. So the first is your punctuation errors. So there are several types of punctuation errors. Most of these arise from an imperfect understanding of what the function of that particular punctuation mark is. And I'm going to be talking about one type of error in particular, which is the comma splice. Now, a comma splice is when you have two complete sentences that are joined by a comma. Now, generally, commas do not join two complete sentences. They would join a complete sentence, which is two sentences which are already connected together by a conjunction. In that case, it's fine to have a comma connecting them. This will be easier to understand with an example, so I'll show you. Antimicrobials can be used to control the spread of the bacterial infectious disease in high-risk production animals, comma, this process is referred to as metaphylaxis. Now, here, these two sentences, the one before the comma and the one after the comma, are two complete sentences. Now, because of the way that commas are used in English, this is not the correct use of the comma. Now, comma cannot on its own be a joiner of two complete sentences. Now, there are honestly so many ways to fix an error like this, but this is something that most native speakers might not actively recognize as being an error, but if they read the sentence, they feel that something is wrong. And when they start feeling that something is wrong, they're distracted from what you're saying. They're thinking, oh, something is strange about this sentence. I need to go read it again to understand it. And that, as a scientific writer, is exactly what you want to avoid. Right, so to fix this, there are, like I said, multiple ways. I'll show you a couple of them. The first is you replace the comma with another punctuation mark, which is more suited for this purpose. Now, in this case, you can use a semicolon. A semicolon can be used to join two related sentences. And the advantage of using a semicolon is a semicolon also implies that the two sentences are related. So in this case, if you use a semicolon, you are sort of indirectly letting the reader know that the second sentence is a sort of a definition of what you're describing in the first sentence without actually having to spell it out. So this is one way that you can fix the comma splice. There's another way, which is that you simply split it into two separate sentences with a period in the middle. And this is a very simple way of fixing this error. And this is not something that anybody's ever going to argue with. If you do this too often, you might end up with a lot of very short sentences, which again can be a little distracting. So you want to use this a little bit judiciously. But this is a very easy way to fix it. For a different type of sentence, you might want to just add a conjunction. So for example, antimicrobials, blah, 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 in high-risk production animals, comma, and this practice is referred to as metaphylaxis, which is also perfectly grammatically correct. You might want to be a little more judicious again about using this type of a fix for a comma splice, because again, you're implying a connection between the two sentences. So you want to make sure that there is actually a connection between them. But this is another way of fixing the sentence. Move on to the next error type, which is the subject-verb agreement error. Now, subject-verb agreement is something that is sort of one of the cornerstones of the way sentences are structured in English. Now, all sentences in English should have a subject and a verb and an object. Now, the subject and the verb should match each other in number and in person. So what does this mean? For example, the use of antibiotics in human and animal medicine have resulted in an acceleration in the selection and spread of antimicrobial resistance. Now, what is the problem here? The verb in this sentence is have, right? It's an auxiliary verb. But the noun in the sentence, the subject of the sentence, which is the thing that the sentence is about, is the use of antibiotics. Now, use is singular because it is an abstract noun. And abstract nouns generally are not used in the plural form. So now, because you have the singular form use, and then you go further down the sentence and suddenly you have a plural verb have, which is, you know, we have rather than, you know, he has, she has, so plural form. This again is going to trip up the reader. He may, like I said, may not even necessarily realize consciously that something's wrong with the sentence, but he has to go read the sentence again. He's distracted from what the sentence is actually saying. So this is not something that you want to happen. This is a very easy way to fix the sentence. You look for the noun and then you ensure that the verb matches it in number. So the use of antibiotics has resulted. Now, why this can be a problem in scientific writing in particular is because science writing tends to have pretty long sentences. So what can happen is that the noun and the verb can become very distant from each other, just in terms of the number of words that are between the noun and the verb. So because of that, you might not remember while you're writing that this is the noun that my verb needs to agree with. So you need to be a little bit careful, especially when you're constructing very long sentences, that you don't do this.
And this actually leads nicely into the next error category that I wanted to talk about, which is something that I personally feel quite strongly about, which is errors related to sentence structure. And here I'm going to talk specifically about misplaced phrases. So for example, cultural assets were explored, chemical fertilizer and household garbage were found all over the reservoir, which are considered to be major threats to the survival of the reef turtle. Now, here, obviously, the authors are saying that chemical fertilizer and household garbage are considered to be major threats to the survival of the reef turtle. But because this phrase, which explains, you know, what these major threats are, is close to the word reservoir, the reader's mind automatically assumes that this phrase is a description for the word reservoir. Now, obviously, the reservoir is not a major threat for the survival of the turtle. So the interpretation that the reader would get from a sentence that is structured like this is incorrect. So what you want to do here is you want to take this long phrase and you want to move it as close as possible to what it is describing. So that's, again, very easy to do because you say cultural assets were explored and chemical fertilizer and household garbage, which are considered to be major threats to the survival of the reef turtle, were found all over the reservoir. Now, this is not the only way to fix this. You can do many things to ensure that this explanatory phrase is close to the words that it is describing. For example, you could say cultural assets were explored and chemical fertilizer and household garbage were found all over the reservoir, full stop. These are considered to be major threats to survival of the reef turtle. I would still say this has some room for improvement because you're still not making it clear that you're talking about the fertilizer and household garbage. But like I said, there's more than one way to fix a sentence. What's most important is you identify the problem. You say, okay, why am I rereading this sentence and why am I finding it difficult to read? Which brings me to something else that I think is really important in scientific writing, which is to sort of give yourself a one-step remove from your writing after you've completed it and go back and say, okay, is the message that I want to convey actually getting conveyed? So try to read your writing as a third person. And the way that I usually like to do this is I like to sort of leave the writing alone for a little while, even if it's like an hour or so, and then come back and look at it with fresh eyes and say, okay, does this sentence actually convey what I'm trying to make it convey? One more error we'll talk about, which is the lack of parallel structure. Now, what is parallel structure? Parallel structure basically means that if you have a sentence which contains a list of multiple items, the reader expects that all the items in that list will be in the same format. So if any one item in the list is in a different format, then the reader becomes confused because he needs to go back and say, oh, did I misinterpret the other two items in the list? So for example, a total of 84 heifers were enrolled in the trial, 26 allocated to corn is the control, 28 to ENR, which is one treatment group, and TUL contained 26 distributed in 6 cohorts. Now, as a scientist, as a professional, you will look at the sentence and you know exactly what it is saying. There are 3 groups, 26 were in the first group, 28 were in the second group, and 26 were in the third group. But as a reader, you would have to go back and read the sentence again because of the way you say 26 to corn, 20 to ENR, and TUL contained 26. Now, again, this is very easy to change. You just say 26 allocated to corn, 28 to ENR, 27 to TUL. Very easy to fix. Okay. And one last one, which is wordiness. Now, the only reason I bring this up is I think because, again, scientific writing does tend to be kind of on the wordy side because you have a lot of complex ideas to convey. But it becomes all the more important that you keep your language as simple as possible so that the reader can concentrate on the complexity of what you're saying. So, for example, together with other carbohydrate-utilizing bacteria, higher relative abundances of A and B genera were found in the gut of 3-week-old dairy calves, which coincides with human liver with solid intake and greater concentration of short-chain fatty acids. This is a 37-word long sentence. It's quite a long sentence. There's quite a lot of information that's been packed in here. I would actually ideally want to split this sentence in two just because cognitively it is easier for the reader to absorb and, you know, comprehend two separate sentences when there's so much complex information. But even if you want to keep the sentence as a single sentence, it's easy to sort of change the structure of the sentence around so that you don't have as many words, and just the fewer number of words that the reader has to hold in their memory while they're reading the sentence, the easier the sentence is to read usually. So I personally would try to change to something like the guts of 3-week-old dairy calves had, along with other carbohydrate utilizing bacteria, higher relative abundances of A and B genera. This period coincides with rumen development, solid intake, and higher short-chain fatty acid concentration. Now, this is slightly shorter, but what I've done here is instead of having the passive voice, which is were found, I have the active voice, which is had. So instead of something, something, something was found in this, this had something, something, something. Now, the use of passive voice is something that was traditionally a hallmark of scientific writing, of formal writing, because it was felt to be more academic, more formal, more precise for whatever reason. And another reason why passive voice gets used a lot in scientific writing is because the action that is being completed is felt to be more important than the person who's doing the action, which is in this case a researcher. But you want the reader to concentrate on what is being done. So what is being done, which is again passive voice. But more and more now journals are starting to feel, scientists are starting to feel, readers are starting to feel that this may not be necessary. And the amount of complexity that passive voice introduces into the language is maybe taking away from the communication of the science. So more and more now journals themselves are saying, don't use the passive voice, use the active voice, say we found, say we assessed, we studied. It's fine because the simplicity that that brings to the language is actually improving the ability to convey the message. Okay, so that's really all that I'm going to say about scientific writing, because like I said, I can talk for a day about this and not get tired of it. So we'll move on to manuscript structure, which is what I want to spend a little bit of time on, because in terms of language, you generally tend to have an idea of, okay, you know, things need to be simple, things need to be easy to understand. But manuscript structure is also a lot about the reader's expectation. And the more you play into the reader's expectation, the easier it is for the reader to absorb your message. So why is manuscript structure important? It imposes a logical sequence in the flow of ideas. So it sort of streamlines your own thinking into, okay, this, you know, this comes first, then came this, and therefore this. It ensures that the message you want to convey is the same message that the reader receives. So a structure reduces the possibility of misinterpretation. It presents complex science in a simple form, and it conforms to reader expectations. And like I said, this helps because the more you conform to expectations, the easier it is for the reader to absorb what you're trying to convey. So in order to understand manuscript structure, you first need to understand what is the purpose of the manuscript. The purpose of a manuscript is to answer the four W's, which is why is the study important? What methods were used to conduct the study? What were the study's findings? And what were the significance of the findings? Right. So I'm going to spend a lot of time showing you screen caps of published articles. I have, as far as possible, tried to add the citation so you can find those articles yourself. Most of them are from open access journals. But I wanted to focus on this abstract in particular to illustrate the point that I'm making here about the four W's. Okay, so let's have a look at this, right? So the first W, for the first W, okay, is why.
This is Yukti. Actually, some of the participants want us to take it slowly, especially the examples. So can I request you to slow down a bit and then take them step by step? Okay, thank you.
Okay, does anybody want me to go back to the examples?
And slow down the pace.
Okay, perfect. Okay, all right. So in terms of the abstract, so the first W is why was the study conducted? We'll talk a little bit more about abstracts in particular, so I won't go into that right now. But for now, we'll focus on the four W's. So the why is something that the reader should see right away. So that should be at the beginning of the abstract. Why was it done? So now you say rabbits are popular as pets. However, problem of otitis caused by blah, 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 blah. And there are treatments available, and therefore an evaluation of that treatment was carried out in the present study. So that is the why. So the next question you want to answer is what was done to actually address this question? So the method, and that should come next. So here is the methodology of the study. So here the authors are talking about how many rabbits they used, how the treatment was done, how they actually examined the rabbits, and so on and so forth, right? Okay, so that's your method. The next thing you want to know is what were the results that came out of the method that you were using? So that's your third thing. What was found? You should immediately follow the methods, obviously. So here are the main findings of the study. All the lesions were classified as so on and so forth. A week after providing medication, there was a decrease in the lesions of the group. So that is your finding. And the last thing that you need to do with your study is explain why this finding is important. What does this study tell the scientific community that we did not already know before? So that is the end, which is administration of a single dose of this treatment was effective for the treatment of this infection in rabbits. So this is how your study should answer these four W questions. Now, these four W questions are basically what inform the commonly accepted structure of a scientific manuscript, which is the IMRAD format. You'll see this quite a lot when people talk about scientific writing. And the IMRAD format basically follows the same logic of the four whys. And it follows what is called an hourglass structure, and I'll explain why it's called that. So the first thing is, why did we do it? That is the introduction, so the I of IMRAD. Next thing is, what did we do? Methods, which is the M of IMRAD. What did we find? Results, which is the R of IMRAD. And that lowercase a is, depending on whom you ask, some people say it stands for analysis, some people say it stands for and. But basically the D of IMRAD is the discussion, which tells you what does it mean, what is the significance of the findings, why are the findings important, what is the context of these findings. Now I'll come back to this hourglass structure a little bit later in more detail. I think once you've gone through the entire manuscript structure, it'll be easier to understand why the structure is there. But basically the hourglass structure means that you go from a broad general description down to your very specific research question and what you did to address that research question. And then you have to broaden your perspective again to place those findings in the context of the already known body of knowledge, which is why it's called the hourglass. Okay. So what are the components of a manuscript that help you to achieve this effect? These are the general components of a manuscript: the title, the abstract, the keywords, introduction, methods, results, and discussion. The other components of the manuscript that I'm not mentioning here are the tables and the figures, largely because these are usually tied into the methods and the results. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in detail later. Okay, so let's first move to the title. The title of the study summarizes the study in under a sentence. That could be a very long sentence, or it could be a very short sentence. I have seen very effective titles that are just 5 words long. I have seen titles where the authors were obliged to put in so much information that the title had to become about 20 words long. But there are ways to make even a long title effective, and we'll talk about that. The other thing that the title should do is make the study interesting to its target audience and make the study accessible to its target audience. So these are two different things, and what do I mean by them? To make the study interesting to its target audience, I mean that, for example, if you want to focus on the fact that you used X medication in a previously unreported group of patients, that is what you want to emphasize for your audience. So your title should make it clear to the reader without even reading the abstract that you are saying, hey, my study is important because I have used this medication in this population. So that's what I mean by make the study interesting. Now, in terms of making the study accessible, this is to do with the way that databases and search engines retrieve and identify scientific articles. Now, they use what is called search engine optimization. They use indexing, and that indexing depends on keywords. So if your title contains the keywords that are most relevant to your study, then somebody who is looking for articles that contain those keywords will find your study much more quickly if those keywords are in your title. It's that simple. Okay, so let's look at a couple of titles in particular. Okay, so this is again the title of a study: evaluation of the effect. It's the same study as the abstract that I showed you earlier. Evaluation of the effects of this drug in the treatment of rabbits naturally infected with this pathogen. Now, the first thing you want to see when you want to make the title effective is if you want to identify the essential components of the title. So what are the essential components of this title? Obviously the treatment, right? The study population, the treatment population. And I would say that the word treatment itself is also important for the study because it relates the treatment to its population. Now, what is not important to the title, what is almost never important to the title, is this evaluation of. Because when you're writing a title of a study, the reader automatically assumes that whatever you're studying is being evaluated. So you're basically that evaluation of, study of, assessment of, investigation of, these words are all redundant. And in a title, you have to weigh each word in gold, right? Each word has a weight. And the less words you have in your title, the more emphasis you can place on the words that you want the reader to focus on. So any extraneous information, any extra words, as far as possible, should be eliminated from the title. So the first thing that I would do if I saw this title is remove evaluation of. And I would give you a title something like this. Effect of in the treatment of study population. Now here you see again you have your first important element present in the title, your second important element present in the title, and your third important element present in the title. Again, I think that this can be further improved by removing some additional unnecessary words, which for me is effect of. Now, obviously, if you're assessing the effect of a certain treatment regimen in a study population, you are looking at the effect of that treatment regimen. So is it really necessary to use the words effect of? I would think no, and I would change the title to something like this. Blah, 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 for the treatment of rabbits naturally infected. So this has all three of your important elements and almost no other extraneous words except for a couple of prepositions. So this has a couple of advantages. One, any search engine optimization or indexing process that is looking for afoxalina or the pathogen in question, all of those will pick up this title, and somebody who's looking at the title will immediately know what the study is about and will know whether or not it is interesting to them. What can go wrong with the title? Plenty, as a matter of fact. And I'm focusing a little bit on the title because I think this is kind of an underrepresented part of the manuscript when people talk about manuscript writing. So first thing is the title can be too long. We've talked a little bit about why that's a problem, because if you have a very long title, then you're distracting the reader from the message that you want to convey. So for example, use of validated objective methods of locomotion characteristics and weight distribution for evaluating the efficacy of ketoprotein. Now, I see a lot of unnecessary words here. I'm not going to go into how we would fix this title. I just wanted to show you a title that is very long. I would maybe remove the words evaluating, like I said. And I would probably want to emphasize the fact that you examine the efficacy of ketoprofen rather than the method that was used. So I would maybe put that first. So say efficacy of ketoprofen in alleviating pain in cows with limb pathologies, and then maybe have a subtitle saying using validated objective methods of locomotion characteristics and weight distribution. So that's one way in which a title can go wrong. One is a title's bond breach, which is a title that does not lead with what is important. We saw a little bit of an example of this in the previous title, where the primary thrust of the study was sort of pushed in at the end of the title rather than being right at the beginning. So another example of this, metagenomic analysis of antibiotic resistance genes in dairy cow feces following blah, 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 blah. Now, neither metagenomic analysis nor antibiotic resistance genes are novel. Metagenomic analysis is a well-known methodology. Antibiotic resistance genes are a well-known phenomenon. So should a title where you want to emphasize the novel findings that you are presenting start with these very well-known things? Ideally not. You ideally want to have what is new presented as early as possible so that it catches the reader's attention. And then later you can explain that this is how we arrived at this information. So that's something that can happen. The third thing is a little bit interesting, which is what I call clickbait, which, I mean, if anybody who's had access to the internet in the last 5 years knows what clickbait is, basically misrepresenting what you are promising the reader. So a title that doesn't, that overstates or that doesn't appropriately reflect what is actually the content of the paper that you're reading. For example, antibiotics threaten wildlife. Now, this is the main title. So this is the first thing that the reader is going to read. And then you have a subtitle which actually tells you, okay, circulating quinolone residues and disease in avian scavengers. That is what the study is about. Now, this does have some implications for the effects of antibiotics on wildlife, but can you really go from such a very specific study case to this extremely general antibiotics threatening wildlife? In this specific case, it might not have been an inappropriate thing to do, but in most often, you should not go from the specific to the very, very general without a very good reason for doing that. So this is one of the things that I found it extremely difficult to find published articles with titles like this, because this is something that most journal editors will catch very early and say, you're overstating your findings in your title, you need to change your title. So a good journal editor will not let an article get published with a misleading title. which is why I found it a little difficult to find these. And this is kind of an interesting case. I will not go into this in detail because this is going to be covered in a lot more detail in the second session. But basically, this particular article, antibiotics threaten wildlife, was actually retracted because they were unable to verify some of the data. And in fact, they were unsure whether one of the authors even actually exists. So that's just an interesting side note. But it's a little bit of a cautionary tale that try not to overstate your findings too much, because that can lead down some unpleasant roads. Okay, we'll move on to more pleasant things. We'll move on to the abstract. So now the abstract has a very unique function in scientific writing, because most often a lot of journals, I would say the majority of journals, unfortunately now, are not open access. So most of the time, unless you're publishing in the subset of journals which is open access, your reader's not going to have access to your full study. They're going to have access only to your title and your abstract. So in that case, your abstract becomes essential because it tells the reader, this is what is the content of the study. So now you know whether you want to actually go and ask for access to the full paper, whether that's in terms of having a subscription or getting the paper from some other source or whatever. But they need the abstract in order to know whether the study is going to be useful to them to read. So therefore, the overview that is provided by the abstract becomes essential, because you need to encapsulate everything that's important about the study in the space of about, usually about between 200 and 400 words. So now, obviously, you're not going to include all the elements of the study in that. There's a reason why you have to have the entire paper to explain your findings. But you need to sort of pare down and take a step back from your study and say, what is actually important? So usually, this what is actually important question can be answered by following the structure that an abstract normally has, which is your background, your aim, your methodological approach, your principal findings, and your conclusion or your significance. Other things that the abstract should do is it should explain the dependent and independent variables. But the independent variable is the thing that you control. The dependent variable is a thing that you observe, usually. A very, very broad definition. So, for example, if you have a study population and you're administering a treatment and you want to see the effect of that treatment on, say, the white blood cell count. So your independent variable is your study population and your dependent variable is your white blood cell count. So both of those things should be represented in your abstract, because that is what you want the reader to know, because that's what you've done. Obviously, you want to know the study animal or population used. You want to know the condition of animals or subjects in the study, and you want to know the experimental approach. Okay. Now we'll go back to the rabbit abstract that we looked at earlier, and we'll look at this in a little more detail. So the first thing is your background. Why was it done? So that's the background or aim of your study. So this explains why the study was necessary and what the specific question was that the study set out to answer. So that should be here. Next, what were the methods used? Right? So this should explain, like I said, the conditions of the animals in the study. It should tell you what the dependent variable was. It should tell you what the independent variable was. It should tell you the experimental approach. All of that should be in your methods. There is a temptation to make the method section of the abstract very long, and that's to be avoided if possible, but sometimes the methodology is complex, so you do need to go into it in a little bit of detail, because without that, the reader won't understand the result. But try to condense this to the most relevant methods. Next, what was found? That is your findings. Again, you want to limit your findings to the most important or the most significant. For example, if you say your study contains some 19 animals and two of the animals died, that's probably not something that you want to spend real estate on in the abstract, because you want the abstract to focus on your study findings. While the reader should definitely know at some point when assessing the results of your study that two of the animals died, that's not the most significant finding of the paper, and you don't want to devote space in the abstract to that finding. Now, that space in the abstract is a premium, and like the title, every word has to count. So you need to really carefully weigh what information you want to put in the abstract versus what you want to leave for the reader to find out in the main text. The last thing that the abstract should do is it should tell you why the study is important, what does it mean, what is the significance. Because again, this is something that the reader needs to know in order to gauge whether the study is interesting to them, whether it is interesting to science, whether it is worth pursuing to the full paper. Okay, so what can go wrong? Obviously, information in the abstract can be missing. That's one of the main things that can go wrong. The background or the methods or the significance can be missing. Most often what I see is missing background. So there's an abstract that immediately begins with, this study aimed to do blah, 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 blah. Now, while this dives right into what was done and what was found and why is it important, this doesn't tell you what the research question was. This doesn't tell you why that research question had to be asked. So without that, the reader doesn't know why they should care. So that's very important for even if it's one sentence, you should have that in the abstract. Like I talked about, overemphasis on methods or results at the expense of other information. That's why I say that try not to have too much methodology, because if you only have 200 words in the abstract and you're spending 100 words of that just talking about the methods, then you obviously have less space to talk about everything else. Another thing that can go wrong in the abstract is having the main findings not being emphasized. So if, for example, if you want to put all your results in the abstract, including animals that died, including a couple of results that were not very conclusive, then the principal findings, the findings that you really want the reader to know about, can get drowned out. So that's something you should avoid again. You definitely should not present information in the abstract that you don't also present in the main text, because then your abstract is not appropriately representing your full manuscript. And there's one final thing that can go wrong with the abstract, which is, it's a little strange because it's not something that you would usually see in a scientific document, but I thought it was too interesting not to share. So here's the abstract. Not all abstracts are structured like this, with introduction, methods, results, and conclusions as subheadings. It is something that some journals ask for, right? But here in the introduction, the author say, this work shows that blah, 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 blah were positive. Now, this is not an introduction. The introduction should tell you why the study was done. What is the purpose of conducting the study? This is not background information. This is not motivation for the study. This is a result. Then you have the method section, which is more or less the methods. You say the precipitant reaction was used. And then you have the so-called result section, where you say 687 insects were examined. Now, this is not a result. You can't say we examined so many insects and call that a result. So this is actually methodological information, all of this. Then the authors use the heading conclusion, where they say studying the feeding preferences of rat means is an important entomological surveillance since it is necessary, blah, 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 blah. Now, this is an explanation for why the authors felt the study was necessary. So this really is background information that should have been in the introduction section. And then finally, in the last sentence of the abstract, they finally come to the conclusion of the study, which is the only part of this abstract that is in the right place. Okay, so this is kind of a cautionary tale abstract to ensure that you, this is why manuscript structure is important, because I read this abstract, I'm extremely confused. Why was the study done? What were the methods? What were the findings? What is the significance? If I had all of this information just reordered and put in the correct structure, then this would be a very effective abstract, because all the elements are there, they're just in completely the wrong place. Okay. Let's move on to the introduction. The introduction introduces the reader to the research problem with context, explains what is known, states the knowledge gap, explains why the study is novel, ends with an aim statement, and optionally a brief overview of the approach. Now, the introduction serves a very specific purpose. Again, like the abstract, it tells the reader why the study was done and in a little more detail than the background. So it says, okay, no, this is the field that we're talking about. This is the status quo in the field. This is what we already know. This is what we don't know. And based on all of this information that I've presented to you already, this is why we formulated the research question the way that we did, based on what is known, based on what is not known, based on the background. And I've said explains why the study is novel. It's an unfortunate but well-established fact that journals prefer to publish novel findings. They don't like studies to tell readers things that is already relatively well known in the scientific community. They want new information, new knowledge. So one of the functions of the introduction is to explain why that study is novel. And the introduction should always end with an explicit aim. You should never finish the introduction of a study. You should never start reading the methods not knowing what research question the authors are asking. So it should always end with an explicit aim statement. Even if you want to go so far to say the aim of the study was, which is best, honestly, because then it removes all the ambiguity. Yeah, so we'll talk a little bit about the funnel structure, because that really brings home why the introduction is such an important part of the manuscript. So this is the funnel structure. So you start with the background for the study, which is quite broad, because you want to take the reader from, okay, here is this broad field of study. So for example, if you are specifically looking at, say, the effect of some possibly anti-cancer drug, you want to start with background about why the need for this study exists, right? So you want to say, okay, so this particular type of cancer is very widespread. It has a high mortality rate, and there is no, you know, accepted treatment methodology for this cancer. So that's your background. And then you move on to the problem, which is that maybe you see several treatment methods have been explored, but all of these treatment methods have some deficiency. Here are the deficiencies A, B, C. Because of these deficiencies, there is currently no accepted treatment for this cancer. That is the problem. And based on the problem, you then move on to your specific aim statement to say that we identified this possible treatment, and the aim of our study is to address whether this treatment is effective for this cancer. So that's your aim. So you move from the very general, which is talking about cancer, that cancer in general, and why it's important to have a treatment modality for it. And then you get more and more and more specific until you come to the very specific aim of your present study. Okay. This is a very, very wordy slide, but I'll ask you to pay attention only to the boxed sentences. So this is one of the things that I like to do when I'm reading an introduction. I like to read the first sentence and the last sentence of each paragraph. So this is the first sentence of the entire manuscript. Consumer preferences play a role in determining which livestock veterinary inputs are used given the structure of animal health services. So this tells you, okay, this introduction begins talking about consumer preferences. So you already know that. Then you move to the last sentence, say, while it is clear that consumers often make decisions about technically complex products, it's not understood what factors drive these decisions. So, okay, so now you know, okay, you're talking about consumer preferences and you're talking about what are the factors that may affect consumer preferences. So you have a general idea of where in the field of, you know, this particular field, this particular study is situated. Now you move on to the next paragraph. Now you start talking a little bit more specifically about thermotolerant vaccine formations and say, okay, so this is what thermotolerant vaccine formations are, therefore it is highly valued. And then you move closer and closer. And at the end of the paragraph, you say it's not well understood how thermotolerance is considered in the decision-making process of final consumers. But this harks you back to your first paragraph where you're talking about consumer preferences in general. And now you're saying we don't know to what extent thermotolerance influences consumer preferences. So you're moving from your background, very general background, to a problem statement, which is we do not know what influence this factor plays in the question that we're asking. And then you move much more specifically, say, okay, this is what is known, right? And then you go down to the main aim stream, which is this research addresses consumer preferences when choosing between two veterinary vaccines directed against Newcastle disease. So that's your very specific aim statement. What is the study actually aiming to answer? Now, the rest of the paragraph actually will give you a brief overview of the methodology. Like I said, this is optional. You don't have to add this, but it does help to give the reader a very brief, usually a couple of sentences like it is here. What you want to avoid is something I'll talk about in the next slide. The first most important thing that you need to ensure the introduction is that the gap in knowledge that you're trying to fill with the present study is clear. If that is not clear, then that kind of makes it difficult for the reader to understand why you did the study. The next thing is that your study aim, like I said, should always be clear. You should never go into the method still wondering what is a research question. The next thing is too much methodological information in the last paragraph. So going back to the previous slide, there are a couple of sentences here. We use a mixed method study to consider how factors such as blah, 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 blah. Okay, so that's one sentence of methodology. That's fine. If you have an entire paragraph saying, okay, so we use 12 cows to do this, we split this into two groups, one test group, one control group. Then we applied this treatment to the test group, and then we tested, you know, urine or whatever after 12 days and so on and so forth. This amount of detail is something that the reader is going to immediately come to the method section and read. So they don't need to know all this in the introduction. So the end of the introduction, if you're giving a methodological summary, should be very, very brief. One thing you definitely don't want to do is sum up the entire study. So now what some authors will do is they'll say, okay, this is the study aim, this is the method, this is the principal finding, and this is why it is important. Now, if you've already told the reader all this, what is their motivation to go on and read the rest of the paper, right? So you definitely want to ensure that you give the reader the overview so that they have the context to understand what you're presenting next. But you don't tell the reader so much that the rest of the article becomes redundant. Another sort of temptation that authors tend to fall into when they're writing the introduction is they tend to try to turn the introduction into a literature survey. Now, the introduction is not a literature survey. It's not trying to give you a review of the literature. It's not trying to tell you everything that is happening in the field. The only information that the introduction needs to have is the information that the reader needs to understand why the study was done. So everything, going back to the funnel structure, everything has to converge on this point of the aim of the study. Anything that is not immediately relevant to the aim of the study does not belong in the introduction. It should be in a review article, which is a completely different beast. And yeah, the funnel structure not being followed. So if, like I said, this plays into reader expectations. So the reader expects that you're going to take them from the general to the specific to the explicit aim statement. If you subvert that expectation, and if your introduction just goes all over the place, for example, if sometimes what authors will do is at the end of, they have multiple paragraphs devoted to each aspect of the study. At the end of each paragraph, they'll say, this is not known. Then again, they'll start with a very general paragraph, go to the end of the paragraph and say, this is not known. So then the reader becomes confused about what is the gap in knowledge that the study is actually aiming to address. So if you use the expectation that the reader knows, okay, I'm going to go from the general to the specific, then the reader knows that, okay, as you go progress towards the aim, I know where you're going with this. You don't want to surprise the reader in the introduction. And the last thing is about abrupt transitions between paragraphs, which is, it's not specific to the introduction. It's just not very good writing to have paragraphs jumping from one to the other with no connection between them. Okay. We move on to the methods. I think I'm running a little bit out of time, so I'll try to keep things brief. Okay, so obviously your method should state your study design. It should provide a description of the methodology. It should provide a statement of ethics approval. It's particularly important when you're working with animals. It should be presented in logical order, which means that the methods also should not jump from one thing to another. So there are, again, certain expectations that readers have when they read a method section. They expect that you'll describe the animals before you describe the treatment or before you describe the intervention that you're using. And the last thing the methods usually should do is explain the statistical analysis used on the data. So here is a method section from a published paper. So here are your subjects, right? Here, 10 mid-lactation premiparous Holstein cows. Those are the subjects of the study. Then here's your experiment and your experimental conditions, your infection and treatment. Here are your procedures and protocols, how milk, blood, and temperature data were collected. Here's your reagents and equipment. Here, there's not really much in the way of equipment. There's just this one particular strain of streptococcus that was provided by someone. So they've given full information about that. Here's your ethics approval. Ethics approval, again, is usually at the beginning of the method section or near where you describe the animals. And finally, here's your statistical analysis, which not all journals insist on having a separate paragraph for statistical analysis, but it's always good to have it. Even if your analysis is very simple, even if it's just a question of, we use the student's t-test to compare the test and control groups, having that separate ensures that the reader knows exactly how you analyze your data. So that's always helpful. Okay, so what can go wrong? Your subheading is not in logical order. So like going back to the previous thing, if I started talking about the collection of milk, blood, and temperature data, then suddenly I said, oh, by the way, we used, you know, 10 Holstein cows. That's not in a sequence that the reader expects, because the reader expects to know, okay, what are you actually conducting these analyses on before you actually start to describe the analyses. So that's what's meant by subheadings presented in logical order. Missing information is actually the most common error in the method section: missing ethics approval, missing vendor information, missing information for equipment, catalog information, statistical analysis not being present. Again, this is less fatal if the analysis is simple, and it's obviously a lot more of an oversight if the analysis is complex. But even for a simple analysis, an explicit statement of how the data were analyzed is really important. And the last thing is unnecessary detail for cited methods. So very often, especially if you're doing like microbial analyses or if you're doing biochemical analyses, you're using a method that's already well established in the literature. And if that is the case, then you don't want to devote too much real estate in the method section to describing something that has already been explicitly and, you know, described in detail in a previous publication. It's if you're not modifying the method in any way, then it's perfectly acceptable to say this method was used, cite the publication in which that method has been explicitly described, let's say we used it exactly like that, and leave it at that. You don't need to then describe the entire method again in detail. The only time you need to describe methods in detail is if you are modifying the method for your own use. And even in that case, normally you will only need to describe your modification, not the entire method. Say, for example, if you're using a method of protein estimation, if you change the concentration of one of the reagents that you used for the protein estimation, you only need to say, oh, instead of using 10 micromolar, we use 15 micromolar. And then you don't need to describe the rest of the method because the rest of the method is the same as that already described in the literature. I realized that was a little bit quick, but it's a minor point, but it helps to make the methods more streamlined and a little bit, like I said, you don't want to devote real estate to something that's already well known. Okay, let's move on to the results. The results present the new information that is generated by the authors using the methods that were previously described. Now, in the results section, when I say results section, I'm talking about the actual text of the results as present in the manuscript. There you want to prioritize results over data. And we'll talk a little bit about what that means. Okay. So here's your result. All 10 animals were successfully infected with so-and-so, so-and-so, so-and-so. That's a result. Now the box text says there was a significant effect of the D3 treatment. In addition, there were significant reductions in milk bacterial counts at the 4th, 6th, and 9th milkings in the treatment group as compared to the control group. This is a result. There are no numbers here. The authors are just saying, this is what we found. We looked at the test group, we looked at the control group, and these are the differences between them. This is a result. Contrast that with what is actually presented in figure one, which is this. Figure one actually has numbers. Figure one has a graph. Figure one says, oh, there were, you know, so many milkings after the infection, bacterial count was so-and-so, so-and-so, so-and-so. Now, these are numbers. These are data. This is what the authors actually collected over the course of the study. These data are analyzed, subjected to statistical tests, and those statistical tests are actually what give you the results that you then present in your results section. Now, the results section should not contain too much data. Data should be presented in either figures or tables. That is the general rule of thumb. Okay, so when do you use text, when do you use tables, and when do you use figures? You present data in text when it's not extensive or complicated. Say, for example, if you have a study population of 20 animals and you say the mortality rate was 50%. That's a very simple, a small, simple data point. Mortality rate was 50%. It would be unnecessary to present this in a table or a figure because it's just one sentence and you're done. You also use text when the data are peripheral or not related to the main study finding. So going back to the two hypothetical rabbits that I killed off when I was talking about the rabbit study in the abstract section, that's peripheral to the findings because your findings are going to be focused on the 17 rabbits that survived and not the two rabbits that died. So if the data are peripheral, like say two rabbits did not survive the entire treatment course, that's a peripheral data point and you can put that in text. In contrast, you use a table when you have numerous values that you need to present in a small space. So for example, if you conducted say 10 different biochemical tests on the control population and the test population, now that's going to be 20 numbers. Say for example, if you have a total protein content in urine or total WBC count, or total creatinine or whatever. These are going to be 20 different numbers. If you want to list all 20 numbers in a paragraph in the text, that's going to be very complicated for the reader to understand. They're going to lose interest. They're going to lose focus while they're reading. Instead of that, you have a table. You have all the 10 tests in rows in the first column. Then you have test animal, control animal. And for each test animal, control animal, you have the corresponding number in the corresponding row. So that presents all 20 numbers in 10 lines, and it's completely understandable to the reader. You also use a table if you want to compare values or characteristics. So going back to your test animals versus control animals, if you have the two numbers side by side, you can say, oh, okay, so protein content was much higher in the test animals than in the control animals. Then you want to show this presence or absence of specific characteristics. Let's say, for example, you have 10 different treatment groups and you want to present whether symptoms of infection were present or absent in those 10 groups. So when you have a table, you say present, absent, present, absent, present, absent for each one. So that's tables. When you use figures is when you want to show trends, patterns, or relationships, but the general pattern is more important. So for example, in this figure, what you want to actually convey with this figure is that the bacterial counts were much higher in the test population, that is in the 1,000 micrograms of D3 treated population, than they were in the control population. I'm sorry, the other way around. The bacterial counts were higher in the control population than in the test population. Now, when I look at this figure, I can see that information immediately because it's visual. And I can take one look at these two lines and say, oh, okay, counts were higher in this group than in this group. So that's when a figure is really effective. And if you want to illustrate a sequence of events, so again, going back to the same figure, you say, oh, okay, so the counts increased with the number of bilkings after infection, but the increase was more dramatic for the control group than it was for the test group. So whatever intervention was being applied to the test group was having the effect of lowering the bacterial count. And all of this information I can get from spending 3 seconds looking at this figure. What can go wrong? Repetition of the methods. Usually always in the IMRAD format. The IMRAD format is not just a question, it doesn't just tell you what sections are present, it also tells you the sequence. So it's introduction, methods, then results. So if the methods are immediately before the results, you don't need to then repeat the methods in the results. So for example, going back to our methods, you don't need, now it says milk samples were collected from at each milking twice daily throughout the study. You've already established this in the method section. So you now don't need to go on to the results and say, oh, by the way, milk samples were collected at each milking twice daily. You can immediately just state the results of what the tests were that you performed on those milk samples. Yeah. Repeating material presented in figures and tables. Now, like I said, you reserve the presentation of data for figures and tables, and you use results, the text section, to present the results that were obtained from those data. So for example, in this same example, the results section only says there was a significant effect. Now, if instead the authors had chosen to say, at the fourth milking, the bacterial count in the control section, the control population was blah and the test population was blah, and they did that for every milking where the reduction was significant, that's not really necessary because that information is already present in the figure. So you don't need to repeat in the results. So that's one thing that can happen. And the inclusion of interpreted material better suited to the discussion. Now going back to this example again, there was a significant effect of the treatment. In addition, there were significant reductions in bacterial count. Now, I know as a scientist, I say, oh, okay, so the bacterial count was lower in the treatment group than in the control group. That's a result. The interpretation of that result is that the treatment was able to reduce the amount of infection that was observed in the treatment animals. But that's an interpretation. That's something that you should mention in the discussion. The results are only to present what you found. That interpretation should be reserved for the discussion. Moving on to the discussion and the conclusion. The discussion provides an interpretation of the results and any relationships that are identified. It gives context for the findings in light of previously reported work, whether these findings support or contradict the findings of the present study. It explains any implications. It explains the limitations of the study. This is really important because the limitations of the study tell you what is the context in which I should understand these findings. So for example, say if you source the entire study population from a single farm, that's a limitation because it limits how generalizable your study results might be to other populations. And it ends with a take-home message. This is really important because the take-home message is what tells the reader, okay, this is what I should understand from the study. This is what the study brings to the scientific body of knowledge. Now we'll go back to our funnel structure and we will invert it. Now the funnel structure will be used for the introduction, going from the general to the specific. we now have to reverse that process in the discussion, going from the specific to the general. So first thing that you do is interpret the results. Now the results are specific to your study, so that interpretation is also going to be specific to your study. Then you expand your perspective a little and you say, okay, so other studies that have focused on this have found XYZ. However, we found ABC, and these findings may be corroborated by some previous work, or they might contradict some other previous work. And it's always helpful to talk a little bit about why that is. You may know, you may not know, you may have some hypotheses. The discussion is a place to explain all of that. Fine. Then the next thing that you do is explain the implications of the findings. Now, if you looking at, for example, this, the implication of this finding is quite, it kind of jumps out, because you say, okay, so if this treatment reduces bacterial counts, then this could be a possible treatment, a possible intervention to reduce infection in these cows. So that's an obvious implication. Then you explain your limitations. Like I said, if all the cows were sourced from the same farm, that's a limitation of your study. If the mortality rate was very high, so the study population was very small, that's a limitation of your study. So all of those things should be explained in the discussion or the conclusion. And you end with a take-home message. The take-home message is, like I said, what you want the reader to actually, if you say, okay, if you take only one thing from this 4,000 word document that I have presented to you, it should be this. That's your take-home message. So that should be the most broad perspective part of your discussion, because you're moving from your very specific results to, okay, what do these results mean for the field in general? What can go wrong? You do want to maybe reiterate a little bit of your findings in the first paragraph of the introduction, but again, the discussion comes immediately after the results. So the reader already knows what your findings were, so you don't need to repeat them in the discussion. The other thing that can happen in the discussion is the author might feel like, I need to go over again what the motivation for the study was. So for example, if you say that infection is a problem in dairy cows, then you don't need to explain all over again what the implications of that are, what the economic implications are, and so on, because you should already have done that in the introduction. The introduction is where you explain why the study was necessary. The discussion should explain why the results are important. So they're two completely different things. Although they both will be very heavy with citations and discussions of previous studies, the introduction explains the why, and the discussion explains the what. Okay, then your limitations or take-home message not being present. Explaining the limitations of the study is really important, because like I said, it explains in what context the findings should be taken. And especially if you're talking about interventions or anything like that, then it's important for the reader to know how they can apply your findings. And the limitations, explain to them how those findings can be applied. And the one thing that the discussion should never do is introduce new information. You don't want to suddenly say, oh, by the way, we also applied another treatment, but that was not successful. That's information that should be in the results and not in the discussion. Okay, then in the conclusion, the lack of a concluding statement or take-home message. I think we've explained why that's important, because that's the one thing that the reader should take away from your study. No discussion of the implications or scope for future work. And the conclusion definitely should not reiterate everything that you already said. So you don't need to say, oh, this was the background, this was the methodology, these were the findings, and this is the conclusion. The conclusion should synthesize the message that is being broadly conveyed in the discussion, which is, why was the study important and what should you take from it? Okay. You can combine the results and discussion section. The advantage of this is that you have the results and the interpretation side by side. The only disadvantage, it depends on how you want to present your results. It also depends on how the journal accepts manuscripts. You might have to compromise on the linearity of the results. So for example, if you want to go from, oh, this was the mortality rate in the animals, this was the bacterial count, and so on and so forth, you might have to compromise on the linearity with which you're able to report those findings, because you report the mortality, then you have to have a discussion about the mortality, then you go back to the findings, and then to talk about bacterial count, and then you have to talk about the implications of that again. So it depends on the study. In some studies that might work out well, some studies it might not work out so well. So this is a choice that you can make. Now talking about writing order. So this is the order in which you're actually going to put the manuscript together. Now ideally you would start with saying, this is what we did, this is what we found. Then you want to talk about what those results mean. Then the introduction is where you actually put the case together for why the study was important. So once you've completed the discussion, then you can say, okay, this is why we decided to do the study. Then you write the abstract, because the abstract is supposed to be an encapsulation of the entire main text. So you do that. And then last, you write your title, because your title is what is going to focus the attention of your reader to what is most important in the study. Okay. A quick word about tenses. Tenses, that is verb tenses. So the general convention is that if something is accepted as an established fact, it is reported in the present tense. And if something is a finding of your own study, you present it in the past tense. And there are, again, some expectations that readers have in terms of what tenses will be used in what part of a manuscript. So the introduction usually will be in the present tense, because that is established fact that you're talking about, previous studies that have already been done. Methods and results will largely be in the past tense, because that is your own work. So you can't say, for example, you can't say, we select 10 cows. You say, we selected 10 cows, because you're reporting something that you've already done. And that discussion will again usually be in the present tense, because you're largely going to be talking about previous work with a little bit of use of past tense to contrast the findings of various studies. And I'll show you what that means. Okay, so here's the introduction of a study. Now, pain management is a public concern, because this is an established fact. A prerequisite for alleviating pain is early recognition. Again, that's an established fact. Cattle are a prey species, established fact. Now here, they're talking about the results of two specific studies. So instead of saying additionally early culling and euthanasia are increased, they're saying no, in this specific study, they were increased. Now, because this specific study was being done in the past, you're using the past tense here. But if you're talking about something like a prerequisite for pain, you're using the present tense. Now in the method section, the protocol was approved because this was done in the past. Study was carried out, same logic. Keyword analysis was performed. Now here, you're not explaining an action in the past. You're talking about, you're saying, oh, if you want to find these data, they are present in table one. Now, table one is not in the past. Table one is right there in the manuscript. So this, when you're citing a figure or a table, you cite it in the present tense. So here's the results section again. Results are given in table three, because table three is right there. But we are talking about the results of the study itself showed significant differences, because this is something that happened in the past. Again, showed differences. And again, in the table, were calculated. Okay, now the discussion. Now the discussion starts with an established fact. Ketoprofen has been approved. Ketoprofen is a valuable option, because again, this is something that's well known, well understood, well established. But this is the authors talking about the findings of their own study, and they want to mention that because they're contrasting it to something that's already been done. So the effects of ketoprofen were apparent. Now, because they use the past tense here, I don't need the author to tell me again, oh, this is our own work, because I know that because they've already used the past tense. So this is how the expectations of the reader actually help you to make your message more effective. Now here again, we've gone back to an established fact. Plasma half-life of ketoprofen is less than 2 hours. But here, I want to talk about this again now. Consequently, Wei et al. Reported that the period of 1 hour after administration was theoretically sufficient. Now, why this was, even though you're talking about a study that's already been published? That's because of this. Wei et al. Reported that. So you're talking about a specific study that was conducted at a certain point in the past, and you're talking about one result from that specific study. Therefore, that's in the past tense. Okay. Now I'm just going to go through a quiz. Clearly, I have maybe 5 minutes I'll take for this, or 3 minutes I'll take for this. Okay. So which of the following sections is not covered in the acronym IMRAD? Yeah. Okay. So I think the general consensus is D, abstract, and yes. You're right, it is the abstract. Okay, next, when you're referring to established fact, you use the past tense, true or false? Okay, I'm seeing a kind of a mixed bag of true and false. So I'm actually just going to go back to that slide really quickly. So ketoprofen has been approved.
established fact using the present tense. Key to profit is a valuable option, established fact using the present tense. The logic is that this is true, this continues to be true, therefore you use the present tense. So the correct answer is actually false. You do not use the past tense when referring to established facts. Okay, next. Which of the following points is invalid for the discussion? A, the discussion must restate all the results. B, the discussion must mention the limitations of the study. C, the discussion must discuss the findings of the present study in the context of previous studies. Which point is not valid for the discussion? Yeah, I think overwhelmingly the answer is A, and yes, the discussion should not restate all the results because the results section has come immediately before the discussion section, so that's not necessary. Okay. When referring to figures and tables in the manuscript, use the past tense. True or false? Okay, I think I should clarify this question a little bit. So for example, when I want to tell the reader that I have collated, say I've done a PCR and I want to give the reader all of the primers that I've used for that PCR, I put them all in one single table, table one, and I want to tell the reader, oh, if you want to find the primers, they're in table one. So should I use present tense? Should I say the primers are in table one, or should I use the past tense, primers were in table one? Yeah, so the correct answer is true. When you're referring to a figure or a table in the manuscript, use the present tense. Okay, next question. Which of the following points is valid for the abstract? The abstract must be at least 200 words long for it to be effective. The abstract must always be structured into subheadings, or the abstract is considered a standalone section and must be understood independent of the main text. It's a little bit tricky. Yeah, so I think most people have said C, and you're right. The abstract should be, the box seems to have moved, but the correct answer is C. The abstract is considered a standalone section. It should be understood independent of the main text. We talked a little bit about why that is, because a lot of readers are not going to have access to the main text, and therefore you want the abstract to be understandable to somebody who's not going to be able to see the full text of the manuscript. The abstract is frequently structured into subheadings. When I say structured, I mean like the actual subheading will be present, like background, so-and-so, method, so-and-so. That information should always be present in the abstract, but it's not necessary that the heading should be present. So I hope the distinction is clear. Next, methods must be written in sufficient detail to allow other researchers to reproduce them. Now, this is a little bit of a laddu. I think the answer should be pretty clear. Obviously, you want to provide any researcher who's reading your study with all the information that they need to reproduce it. Perfect. Which of the following points is invalid for the results? The results must be used to simply state the results without including either methodological detail or discussion. The results must be the longest section of the manuscript and all the findings will be highlighted in sufficient detail. And even negative results contribute to research. So this is a slightly tricky question. Which one is invalid? So the results should be used to only state the results. The results has to be the longest section, or even negative results contribute to research. Which is invalid? Yeah, so the correct answer is actually B. I'm so sorry, the box has moved. The correct answer is actually B. It's not necessary that the results is the longest section of the manuscript. In fact, that's very often not true. The longest section of the manuscript I tend to find is usually the discussion, because that's when you need to make the most amount of statements to explain yourself. So the results need not necessarily be long, but they should be detailed. Okay, last question. Last question, figures are more effective than tables for the presentation of data. True or false? It's not really true, and this box has moved again. So the actual answer is B, false. Figures are not necessarily more appropriate for the presentation of data than tables. It depends on the type of data that you're using. If you want to show trends, then a figure is more appropriate. If you want to show numbers or individual data points, then table is usually more appropriate. Okay. I'm just going to move on quickly to one last thing, which is about references and citations. Now, references and citations are obviously of tremendous importance in a manuscript because they are what tells you where you got your information. Science is basically built on the science of what is previously done. So it's of paramount importance that you cite your sources always, right? So there are multiple formats in which you can do this, and depending on the journal that you're submitting to, you might have to change your citation format in order to fit whatever the journal is expecting. So there are three broad categories. One is author date citations, one is numbered citations, and numbered citations can have both chronologically or alphabetically arranged references. And I'll show you what that means. So these are numbered or Vancouver citations. Vancouver is because that's the name of the style of the most common type of numbered citation. So for a numbered citation, this is a numbered citation here, 1, 2, and you have citation, the number 1 corresponding to the first item in the reference list. So when I say citation number 1, I mean CDC, because CDC is number 1 in the reference list. Similarly, citation number 3 corresponds to the third item in the reference list, which is DaCosta et al. And citation number 7 corresponds to the seventh item in the reference list. This is what a numbered list looks like. Numbered citations with chronologically ordered references. Okay. So the other very common format is the author date citation. Author date is exactly what it sounds like. It's the name of the author followed by the date of publication of the paper. So again, depending on what style of author date citations you're using, you might have to list all the authors or only the first author or only the first three authors followed by et al. But for such a citation format, the reference list will be arranged alphabetically. So it'll go alphabetically from A to Z, and you will be able to find the citation in the reference list because of the alphabetical order. So there isn't really any advantage to using one citation style over the other. It's just a question of what the journal prefers. Okay, so now we'll talk about the life of a researcher a little bit. You have, you know, the actual studies that you do, your research. Most researchers will spend some time working on data analysis of actually interpreting the results that they receive. A lot of researchers do field work. A lot of researchers have teaching responsibilities, and the thing that kind of tends to the least useful and the thing with the least payoff is the time that the researcher spends doing journal formatting. Now, there is a journal called PRJ. It's a broad readership journal, like Science or Nature. Doesn't have a very specific niche kind of readership. They, in their formatting guidelines, they say something very nice. They say, we want our scientists to do research, not formatting. And I find that very nice, because if you sort of go back to the previous slide and you look at the kind of effort that is involved in building a citation and a reference list like this, it's very time consuming. It's not fun. It's not a good use of your time if you want to be spending the majority of your time doing science. So in order to sort of reduce the amount of time and effort that scientists have to spend, you're creating these reference lists and adding these citations, there are various reference management softwares that you can use. Some of them are free, like Mendeley and Zotero are largely free. EndNote is probably the most famous of these reference management softwares. Most of these are available as plugins for Microsoft Word or whatever word processing document you use. And the nice thing about them is they let you build your own library, so you can like sort of save the papers that you want to cite, and then, you know, input them into your library and say, okay, I want to cite this paper here, I want to cite this paper here. And then the software also, you can also tell the software which journal you want to submit to, and the software will automatically format the citation and the reference list in the format of the journal that you're expecting. Okay, so just to let you know that this entire process used to be done by hand, but now there is an automation possibility for this. So that actually makes life a lot easier. I personally spend a lot of my time formatting reference lists, so I'm always grateful for anything that reduces the time I spend doing that. Okay, I think what I'll do now is I'll move back to the chat. Okay. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back to the chat and I'm going to see.
A few burning questions for you. Maybe I can pose those questions quickly.
Okay, yeah, that would be perfect. Thank you.
Yeah. So the first question goes like, how do we go about writing a manuscript when a journal doesn't have a format to stick to? Is there any preferred format over the others when there is no template available?
Okay, so when there's not all journals actually provide you with a template. So what I would normally do is stick with the IMRAD format. The IMRAD format is basically introduction, methods, results, discussion. That's the most commonly used format. In terms of citations and references, if the journal doesn't tell you, then you just have to use a consistent format and then hope that at some point the journal will say, okay, this is what we need it to look like. A lot of journals actually will just ask you to send in your manuscript and they will sort of typeset it. So they like change the font and change the citations and things in order to conform to what they expect. But I think IMRAD would be the safest one.
Okay, thank you. So the next question is how to determine which part of the data should go in the main paper and what part should go in the supplementary information?
Okay, so the same kind of decision making that you use to determine what results to add to the abstract should be used in this case. So for example, if I choose to present three results in the abstract, right? I would want the methods that resulted in those findings to be in the main text. So for example, if a very common methodology that's used in most life sciences papers is PCR, but the results of the PCR itself, so the conditions of the PCR, how many cycles, what temperatures, what is the annealing temperature, all of that information probably should be in the main text. But if I have a long list of primers that I use for the PCR, that's just incidental information that you only need to know if you're actually going to run the PCR yourself. So that I would put in a supplementary section.
Okay, thanks. So the next question says, I think I'm echoing. So next question is, what is the ideal word count for the title of a paper? Does the length of title determine the outreach of the paper? And can you share any specific guidelines to make the title more catchy and attractive?
Okay. The first thing I would do is, like I said, once you have identified all the major elements of your title, ensure that those elements are prioritized and any other extraneous words are removed. So like I said, evaluation of, investigation of, study of, remove all of that. That automatically will make your title more catchy. You can use the title subtitle format again to make the title more catchy. So for example, I know that I cited it as an example of a bad title, but like the title antibiotics threat in wildlife, : and then a more specific example of what you mean. That's one way to make a title catchy, but again, you need to ensure that you are not misrepresenting your title. In terms of length, I would think that anything longer than about 20 or 25 words would be too long for a title. So in that case, you want to be judicious about what information you think is absolutely necessary to present in the title and what information can be presented in the rest of the manuscript.
Okay. So we'll maybe take one last question and then we have a lot of other questions which we can take after Sunaina's talk.
Okay, fine.
Yeah. So this question, someone asks you to share the tips that one needs to tips to make an interesting graphical abstract.
Graphical abstract. So either if it depends on the study, actually, this answer is very, very dependent on the type of study that you're doing. If your study is primarily like an intervention based study or a clinical study, then you might want to keep the graphical abstract very sort of abstract in terms of like shapes and, you know, general idealized information rather than trying to represent pathways or things like that. It's a little difficult to answer this question without having a specific study that I can explain. Sorry.
Sure, no problem. Sure. Thank you so much, Malti. We'll take more questions after Sunaina's talk in the question and answers round.
Yeah,
So okay. Thank you. Yep. Thank you so much for this very insightful presentation. I'm sure all our attendees would have benefited from this. So we'll take a small break of maybe 2 minutes because we are running a little late, and we'll join in exactly after 2 minutes at 11:31. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much, everyone.